to take us home with their best, briefest answer to the wise question sent forward: what's next? Shall we organize meetings to ban them around all the country? Give us your briefest, best prescription for all of us to, you know, give our grandchildren the world without us.
You know, in terms of things to do, we know what to do. We need action, we need organization, we need protest, we need all of the... After all, there's a thing called the Tea Party movement in the United States today. We don't come up to its knees in terms of the effectiveness of what we're doing right now. It's not as if we don't know how to do it. It's been done many times before. We did it in the 1980s. So I don't have anything to add except just to do it. But I will add one thought, just a one-word thought that I've mentioned before. And that is that the various elements of this danger and this opportunity need to be brought together into a single picture and related to one another. So the proliferation, disarmament, and so on are brought together. And once again, I think that the way to do that, there is a way to do that. There is a biological weapons convention which bans biological weapons on a global basis. There's a chemical weapon convention that does the same thing on a global basis. There needs to be a nuclear weapon convention, and that needs to be at the center of thinking, organizing, and pulling this thing together. That would be my prescription.
Well, this is happily my cue to say you should be reading the Bulletin of the Atomic Scientists at www.thebulletin.org, where you will find all the latest and the best analysis in ordinary plain language that you can use, read yourself, click on a share with friends. We can do all those kinds of things. I think more seriously, though, we just don't talk about these issues. And as I alluded to earlier, when people do, they say, well, I'm not an expert, but we are all experts about nuclear weapons. We have to be. This is mass destruction without representation. And we all have, I think, talking about terrorists. This is the most, in a way, democratic weapon there is. There's no discrimination. Everybody goes when this falls on us. And yet it's the most dictatorial weapon in its deployment. Only a very few make the decisions about it. It's not like the mobilization for war that we would have. So this situation is unstable. And we need to tip the balance. And we need to do that by talking to one another about the horribleness of the most dangerous technology on Earth. It is a terrific problem and one we all need to work on to solve. And it doesn't even have to be heroic. I mean, just go talk to people. You know, that's all.
We haven't mentioned nuclear waste. Do you want to give us a couple of points?
Sure. There actually is a new Blue Ribbon Commission on what to do about nuclear waste for civilian nuclear. And it is a problem, obviously. The current and best recommendation we have from the scientists who work on this closely is that the storage of it now in what are called dry casks at the site of civilian nuclear power plants will get us probably about 300 years of safely disposing of this. Yucca Mountain, on our board, Allison McFarlane is the expert on Yucca Mountain. She's a geologist, doesn't think that it's a perfect place. There probably isn't a perfect place for nuclear waste. I think there are some thoughts that if we invest in more fundamental science, on nuclear science, that we may be able to find ways to get this nuclear waste to disappear somehow, or at least use it in a way that renders it, if not safe, at least safer. It is a problem. We've run scientists, we won't get into the subject of the responsibility of scientists here, but it's certainly one that's on my mind a lot. And I think it is up to all of us to demand that these materials be carefully dealt with and that we
What do you tell your audiences as you make your way around? What's next?
Each of the other panelists, everything they've said, and I will add to that that the culture of this country and really of the world at large about nuclear weapons has to be challenged and changed very fundamentally. This country is special in a certain sense, not just because it used atomic weapons against Hiroshima and Nagasaki. As I say, we've used them since in a different way, but actually launched most Americans to this day have been misled to believe that the reasons and the discussions that led up to that justify their use, which is to say that we're a country that believes that the most greatest acts of terrorism in human history, and actually that was the second and third, the greatest was the Tokyo firebombing early in 1945, but that all of those were justified and legitimate. And when you start from that, it blinds you pretty much to the situation we're in, humanly. But we're not the only ones who are pressing that. The, if I can put it in context, I could hardly be more against what we're about to do in Afghanistan. We have been doing it. That's an imperial war that's quite comparable to what the Afghans themselves experienced time after time, going back from the Soviets, the British, Genghis Khan, Alexander. They were all defeated. It defeated at the cost of great Afghan life. And it's happened before. We're about to do it again to the Afghans. But that's an imperial war like the others. I don't think we really have come to grips with how different this is, what we're talking about. And when we say maintaining in this year nuclear winter capability on hair trigger alert, which could have a false alarm, as has happened in the past, and comes to any moment, is a degree of horror, I mean, of the character of our species to allow this to happen, that really has to change somehow. And it's not going to be changed by suggesting that these measures are at all adequate. By the way, if I felt confident that next year would be a quite different story, I wouldn't be worried. So he got the program through, and he had to do this, and he did that. Unfortunately, I don't have that confidence. I don't say it's impossible, but I think it is impossible without a different attitude in this country. And I'd sum it up, the bottom line is saying, it should not be the case that a presidential candidate, let alone 7 or 8 presidential candidates, should say, to talk about a nuclear first use against anybody as an option that is on the table. It is a crime against humanity. Maybe some of the others did in their hearts, but they didn't say it. And Ron Paul was the one who said, we shouldn't talk in this way. That shouldn't be possible. So I want to reach a level in this country where when people talk about